In this video, I'll be installing Linux on my 386 like it's 1992. I'll be using a computer I built in a previous video, but first, some background. What drives a man to write an operating system? Well, you see, as part of studying at university, Linus Torvalds was introduced to the idea of Unix. He wanted to run it at home, so after saving for a while, he got a nice 386 computer in January of 91. Despite saving for a while, two-thirds of it had to be paid in installments over the next 3 years. For the next month or so, while his copy of Minix was on backorder, he started up on his new machine and played a lot of Prince of Persia. When Minix finally arrived, he spent another month working around his limitations. Due to the license of Minix, a lot of patches had to be applied manually to the source code, followed by a recompile. But one limitation was the terminal emulation of Minix. It was serviceable for local use, but Linus also wanted to call into the real Unix machines at uni. It started with some code to do task switching in protected mode. That then morphed into a bare metal protected mode terminal emulator. It was around the time when he added a hard disk driver into it that he realized it was starting to look like an OS in his own right. That summer was spent locked up in his dark bedroom with littling ways of social interactions. Aside from Wednesday evenings, when he go drinking at the Spectrum meetings. Spectrum was and is an organization for Swedish-speaking students of math, physics, chemistry and computer science, ran under the Helsinki University Students' Union. Project, if it got released, was initially intended to be named Freaks, a portmanteau of free, freak, and the obligatory X needed in any Unix-like system's name. Privately, he had considered and even used the name Linux, but who named something after themselves? The FTP admins setting up the upload directory for Linux on Helsinki University of Technology's FTP server, Ari Lemke, didn't like the name Freaks though, and decided to name the directory Linux instead. It's worth noting that Ari wasn't even at the university Linus was studying at. He was someone Linus got in touch with over Usenet when he was looking for a copy of the POSIX spec during that summer of code. If someone wants a copy of the POSIX spec, you know they're up to something. On August 25th, 91, Linus finally announced his project on CompOS Minix. The first release, 0.01, was made without fanfare on September 17th, 91. The release was made shortly after Linux was complete enough to run Bash. It never really worked well enough to run for any length of time, and was mostly a token gesture to those following the project. The release wasn't complete enough to compile and run, unless you were told how to by Linus. On October 5th, Linux 0.02 was released. It was the first complete working release. It relied on Minix to be set up, and could barely run a few GNU utilities, like Bash and GCC. It had no floppy disk drivers, and required a root file system to be set up on your hard disk to run. But this cache problem, fixed in 0.03, released a few weeks later, allowed GCC to build more complex programs, but Linux still had many issues. Early December, 0.10 was released. It still relied on Minix for setup and had no virtual memory. It was distributed as two floppies, one boot disk with a kernel and a root disk with a minimal Linux system. This was the first version with floppy disk drivers, although they were so buggy they barely worked at all. There's a myth floating around that you had to manually edit the bootloader with a hex editor to boot from the hard disk, but the installation manual helpfully includes a short C program to do it for you. A week later, 0.11 released. It dropped all mentions of requiring access to Minix. As Linux finally shipped with an MKFS utility, it fixed a lot of the hard disk and floppy driver bugs, and most importantly, it added console beeps. Soon after the release, Linus accidentally used his modem autodialer utility to autodial his Minix partition, corrupting his Minix installation beyond use. Further development on Linux was from that point on self-hosted. On January 5th, 92, 0.12 launched with official support for virtual memory, which was this big killer feature. This was the version that really made it. This version is when things started working quite well, and it could be used by people who weren't operating system programmers. This is probably when the number of users went from a dozen to several hundred. It was good enough that it could have been a 1.0. Well, it was still buggy and crash prone, but it was getting there. It was usable. Also worth noting is that virtual memory was the first major feature that Linus implemented for somebody else and not for his own needs. That release also announced that starting February that year, Linux would switch to the GPL instead of the previously used non-commercial license. This is also when distribution stopped becoming a thing. MCC Interim was one of the first ones out, which packaged more software than just the bare essentials for a functional system. It also simplified installation with more scripts and guides. Several similar small distributions soon followed. Why distributions? Well, you see, Linux is an operating system kernel, the stuff that manages hardware, maintains user security, that kind of stuff. It's more or less a pile of device drivers and a task scheduler. Nothing you interact with is included. All of that had to be obtained somewhere else. A distribution bundles the Linux kernel with system and application programs to make it a complete and functional system. A lot of the programs came from the GNU project, which had freely available implementations of a lot of Unix software. Many of the GNU programs and utilities were considered better than any commercial implementation. GNU didn't have a kernel ready yet, though. So if GNU had all of its software, why didn't they just make a kernel? Well, they didn't have one ready yet. The work on HERD, the GNU kernel, had been ongoing for 2 years at this point, but wasn't at all ready. With a Linux kernel, it was possible to build a complete and functional GNU system. But if the GNU project could produce a great compiler and the world's most over-engineered text editor, why was it so hard to make a kernel? For this, let's look at the now infamous Flamebait post, made by a Minix author, Andrew Tannenbaum, titled Linux is Obsolete. He made two real points in that post, which were quite reasonable for the time. Linux was a monolithic kernel. All kernel stuff ran as one process with no barriers in between. One bug in one part could sabotage another. The gold standard at the time, seen as the future of computing, was the microkernel. A microkernel would keep the amount of code running in kernel space, which can read and write to any process or device in the system, to a minimum. Instead, functionality would be separated out into small user space programs, communicating over a well-defined interface. If one of these system programs crashed, it wouldn't stop the whole show, as the system could just restart that part. The problem was that the interaction of various functionality was often more complicated than the system itself. It was a difficult thing to debug, not surprising as the kernel was composed of dozens and dozens of interacting programs. This was the main reason why HERD was taking so long. HERD was a microkernel. The other point is portability. Linux was making use of a lot of weird 386 features, making it difficult to port to other types of processors. The x86 line of processors were by many considered a dead-end technology. Its complex instruction set would prevent future designs from reaching higher performance, probably never becoming superscalar. There was merit to this idea, as contemporary RISC processors were significantly faster than anything Intel could produce. In 91, a consortium was formed to develop the spec for the next generation of personal computers based on RISC and Unix. It was called the Advanced Computing Environment, or ACE. About as sexy as it sounds. In 92, that consortium dissolved after extensive infighting. By the time the Pentium launched in 93, the idea of x86 being at a dead end was starting to be questioned. But none of that mattered. Linus wasn't trying to build a future. He built something simple that worked. All of this is why Linux exploded, both literally and figuratively. There was this huge trove of software available, but you still needed an expensive enterprise OS and hardware to use it well, until Linux came around. Linux wasn't vaporware, unlike HERD. The next release of Linux was version 0.95, released on March 7th. Big change was the support for logging, allowing for multiple users. No more would init dump you straight into a root console and boot. The huge bump in version number was because Linux was starting to look quite complete. After that, 0.96 followed on May 12th. It introduced two huge new features, initial support for SCSI and the ability to run X11. Finally, Linux could run a graphical user interface. A program could now also link up to 6 shared libraries. On August 1st, 0.97 released. It included a bunch of small fixes, as well as initial support for the extended file system and MS-DOS FAT file systems. Previously, a user-space program called mTools was used to access MS-DOS files. The ext file system was developed to get around limitations in the Minix file system, which was used up until that point, like a maximum volume size of 64 megabytes and short file names. On September 29th, 0.98 launched. Its largest claim to fame was support for TCP/IP networking. Since 1992 was the year of the Linux distribution, what did the timeline look like? First, there's the good old boot roots. It's hard to place in time. All releases from 0.02 and later were a boot disk and a minimal root disk. Prior to 0.10, but really 0.11, a root disk had to be copied to hard disk using Minix before it could be used. MCC Interim followed in February. It wasn't a huge distribution, but optional software disks for it quickly appeared. It made installation easier, and was a more integrated approach. It was seen by its offer as a temporary solution, until the distribution problem was solved for real. Then there's the MJ releases. I couldn't find much about them. It appears it was primarily for upgrading MCC installs to use shared libraries. Based on that, I'm guessing it appeared around May. Next up is Tamu Linux. I struggle with finding contemporary sources for this one as well. A Usenet post from 3rd April described it as a boot, a mini-root, and 4 binary disks, sometimes claimed to be the first to ship X11 as part of its distribution. In July, it's mentioned that an X11 package for MCC is available on Tamu. Early 93, it's mentioned that Tamu is based on SLS. If I were going to speculate, it probably started as a collection of binary packages for MCC, possibly with tweaks to the base MCC distribution. I'm starting to think that the Tamu distribution at this time was just whatever happened to be put into the free Unix directory on sc.tamu.edu. Most of the information available is the same copy-pasted snippets, most of it blatantly wrong, even when translated into Spanish. Which brings us to Softlanding Linux Systems, or SLS. first released in August, touted as easy to install and very complete in terms of software. Based on old Usenet posts, it appears to be mostly assembled from binaries scavenged out of other distributions and releases. It became notorious for its bugs. There's hjloose bootable root. Same as the bootroot, more or less, except it fits on a single disk. It loads the root disk into a RAM disk, allowing the floppy drive to be used for other software. Right at the tail end of 92, there's Yggdrasil Linux. Its name wasn't announced yet. It was a huge distribution, trying to include everything. It could run off a CD-ROM, thanks to the not yet finalized Rock Ridge extensions to the ISO 9660 CD-ROM file system. It did include scripts for hard disk installation. Being at the bleeding edge, it would use the still-in-development extended file system for hard disk installation. It only supported SCSI CD-ROM drives. This was a wild time in Linux. If your distribution didn't include the software you wanted, you'd just get it somewhere else. Binaries were frequently pilfered from other distributions. The practice of grabbing binaries out of random archives and distributions was encouraged. CompOS Linux from 92 makes for some wonderful cursed reading, with users describing their multi-distribution hybrids having strange issues. So now the question is, what do I install? Well, among the fairly complete distributions, the only one I've found a seemingly complete copy of is SLS with kernel 0.98 from November, so that's what I'll be installing. So with great courage, I started booting from the floppy. These early versions of Linux would, at each boot up, ask if you wanted to use a high-resolution SVGA mode. I'm skipping that for now. After swapping in the utilities disk and thundering into fdisk, creating my Linux partition and swap partition, so I'm going for the maximum amount of swap, which is 16 megabytes. Not feeling like tempting fate, I followed the on-screen recommendations and reboot. After a quick peek into the README to find a command for formatting the disk, and a quick peek at fdisk to see how many blocks my partition is, I format the disk with a surface scan. That only took a few minutes. Then, I jump into the install script, only needing to answer a few simple questions. Installing disks A2 and A3 goes quick, but then I run into my first roadblock. It's asking for disk A4. I never got a disk A4. Some modern sources claim it's a bug in the installer, so I skip that disk and do the rest of the setup. A quick reboot later, and it's obvious that I'm missing a whole bunch of stuff, including some of the bug fix packages that would have been an A4. I know there should be some bug fix packages on the disk due to some Usenet posts from the time and the changelog included with the distribution. In an attempt to save this install, I'm rebooting into the installation environment. My plan is to grab as many missing binaries as possible from the installer RAM disk and the utilities disk. After spending some time with that, I once again reboot. I can now admire the menu system. Aside from some mostly outdated documentation, there's nothing too exciting here. It's obvious though, that some stuff is still missing. The FAQ can be read with a bit of patience though. I'm not sure that was a bug. And with that, it's time to install the rest of the disks. I don't really get a say in what it's installing. Everything is loosely grouped into disk sets, and I can choose what disk sets to install. Right now it's doing the B set, or the base set. I'm not sure why Emacs is considered part of the base install, but later I'll be thankful for that. I was having some issues with the Linux source packet, so I ended up extracting that manually. And you know what I said about Emacs? I've never used Emacs in my life. I prefer Vi. But it turns out that due to the missing A4 disk, Emacs is the only text editor installed on my system. Realizing this, I set up my swap space, and then open rc.local in Emacs to enable swap and boot up. Having never used Emacs before, I had to guess my way into save and exit. I think it was Ctrl-X, Ctrl-C. I then tried to find some documentation included for Emacs, which I was not able to. I also quickly set up access to my MS-DOS partition. But next is when it gets really exciting. It's time to install X11. Many from the time describes it as a ritual that is more likely to fail than anything else. But I got a secret weapon. You see, my hardware is supposed to be supported, so I think my chances are good. Well, first I need to feed it all the 7 disks. After looking around in the X386 folder, I find some examples and documentation on how to set up my xconfig. Hiding there was also an amusingly detailed guide on how to maximize your screen space by creating non-standard timings. Why have 800x600 when you could have 832x624? After scratching my head for a while, I find a set of mode lines that look alright for 800x600. When it was time to start it up, I notice a symlink is missing, so X11 isn't in path. I guess that's another bug I had to correct for myself. Well, after being confused for a while regarding where exactly the xconfig file goes. It's in use to leave X11, apparently. Which brings me to the next problem. Can't load the font, fixed. I'm pretty sure I installed all the fonts, so what gives? After messing around with font paths for a while, I made a discovery. In each font directory, there is a fonts.dir file mapping fonts to files. All the files in those fonts.dir files ends with Z, indicating that they are compressed. Except, the fonts on disk aren't actually compressed. So I create a corrected fonts.dir file with the correct file names, and exit it immediately close back down again. Wait for it. There it comes. Excuse the bad capture, I was too excited to play around X11 to realize I needed to tweak my capture settings. This install came with too much stuff to show right now, and the video is long enough as it is. But check it out, it's got Tetris, in color! Next, I tried to set up Lilo, bootloader, on my hard disk. Using Lilo, I won't need to use the boot floppy to boot my system, but as it turns out, the missing A4 disk strikes again. The bootloader stubs are missing from my install, so Lilo is unusable. All in all, this install took me about 2.5 hours, using nothing but the docs on the disk. With the reputation SLS had, I was expecting a lot worse. Given the missing A4 disk and my previous Linux experience, I'd say this is a pass, but that'll do for this video. But before I go, let's just watch this system boot up, uncut and unedited. But that'll do for this video. Check back next week, when I'll be trying to do basic productivity stuff in Windows like it's 1992. Until then, thank you for watching.